So, who's conducting this as well? So we've got an opportunity now really to ask as many questions as you've got.
I just want to ask about the financial part. We're talking about the share issue, and you're also talking about government trust coming up to the QPR game and whatever. Are we saying that the figure I think you mentioned was possibly 300,000 to 500,000 for the share issue? We looked at that separate to any money that the trust already has and any money from the new memberships where people have been joining, and presume the money from the QPR game is going into the club as it stands now rather than to the trust. So are you talking about the 300,000 to 500,000 being a completely separate commitment to any money that is already there?
Well, anything that goes into the club now will help us, you know, take over bid. So, you know, it'll reduce what we're going to pay, what the deficit is, or what we can identify. So this is why we're encouraging you to start now in any way you can.
Yeah, that's good. So what you're basically saying is, any money that you've already got, any money that people are paying now and whatever, when you look at the figure that you're going to need to raise, this money will be taken into account, and it's on top of that, but you'll need to raise the rest of the money, that's what you're saying.
Yes, yeah, that's right, yes.
So you don't need to hold on to any money to pledge it or whatever, rather than join them. Any money that you put in now is going directly into the kitty for the whole thing, yeah?
I think the key thing is that the trust membership money will be just one member, one vote, obviously, unless we get a whole of Newport and Cardiff.
So we only want to put £10 in.
To put £10 in each, it's not going to reach that figure of 300,000 to 500,000. So that figure is more towards the share ownership scheme will be what we'll be targeting to get to that figure that we feel is needed to make sure we're sustainable for the next year.
My understanding is that you're not going to dissolve the existing company, you're going to take it over. And in that case, what are you going to do about the present shareholders? Are you going to compensate them, or will the shares be worthless and the new community shares be the existing equity for the trust?
Yeah, so it's a good question. And it's going to be similar really to some of the other football league clubs that are in supporter ownership. So the trust, is, as some people know, is set up as a community benefit society, so it's incorporated and has limited liability and things already. So as some of you will know, it already holds some shares in the company, which is the football club, which means Newport Association Football Club Limited. So. If we can raise the money and there's enough support for this to go ahead, then the idea is that we'll try and acquire really as many of the shares in the company as possible, which will be transferred and held by the supporters trust on behalf of the supporters. So there may be a situation where, for example, Exeter City, the trust holds about 60% of the shares in the company. But it's got majority control, you know, to make the decisions that it needs to for the business. So I think, you know, that's the most important thing for now is that got control of the business, and you know, acquiring minority stakes, you know, is something that I think will need to be discussed and looked at. You know, as best as possible. There is something that we haven't actually talked about, which is worth bringing in, which is there's a potential that if through the process of this, we're able to get the supporters trust to hold 90% of the shares in the company, there's a possibility of us applying to HMRC to get a tax relief called the Enterprise Investment Scheme, which some people might be familiar with. We've been successful getting this at some of the other offers we've done, Wrexham and FC United's another one, and Bath City at the moment. If we are able to get that, then individual investors, if the deal were to go ahead, would be able to reclaim 30% from their investment, subject to their own tax circumstance. So it's a real potential boost. Obviously, as I say, it's subject to a few things, but it shows the benefit of if we can get up to 90% of the shares. That, for example, if I had £1,000 to invest and the scheme did get an EIS, then I could claim back £300 from that at the end of the tax year, and all that money would still stay in the club. So, you know, these are the sort of things that, you know, hopefully over the next few weeks we need to work through and put out the best possible.
Yeah, I think we are working on
that. One supplementary question. In view of the fact that the trusts are already the major shareholders, are you now responsible for the day-to-day run of the club, or when do you effectively take over? And if so, who is now responsible for the run of the club?
At the moment, we're still not majority shareholder, because we're in the process of going through what James set out in there, at the transfer ownership, due diligence, and actually then put a share ownership certificate together. So in terms of what's happening at the moment, we don't make any decisions. The club is still run by the current board of directors.
Absolutely, you know, they're your shares, they remain as your shares. So, no, we certainly can't do that, and we wouldn't want to do that.
My question is about time scale. I'm just wondering like, when the target amount would be announced, and then how long it would be to raise the money. Because
obviously it's only
a considerable sum, so the time scale to be able to raise it
would
be quite important.
Yeah, well, I mean, from our point of view, we want to get the share offer out as quickly as possible. And I know, as I said, there's been a hell of a lot of work going on, volunteer work going on in the Senate to get to the point where we can launch that. So a lot of the offer is drafted up. In terms of how quickly it would take to get the money in, I mean, we've been involved with 7 or 8 share offers now, and each is a slightly different context, as you can imagine, but I sense some urgency in this one, of course. So I think the urgency will help on a number of counts, not least to understand, you know, who's going to be making the decisions for the club. So, you know, as soon as we know the figure, we'll get the share offer out as quickly as we can, because I think it's, as I said, in everyone's interest to see if there is the interest from people to go ahead with this and move it on, really.
I do think there's potential for sort of an umbrella organisation to embrace all sports in Newport and unite it. I think it's probably got the community aspect of what we were suggesting up there at its heart. Probably the best model where it's happening at the moment is in Bristol, with Bristol City, Bristol Sport, where there's the ladies team, there's the racing team, there's the rugby team, all embraced under the one umbrella and one company, Bristol Sport. I think probably to do that, we probably need to probably work in closely and well with Rodney Parade and the rugby teams first, and then perhaps trying to spread out to other sporting partners in the community to develop that link.
It was interesting to see the slide with the information on governance, and obviously the long-term aspiration is that you'd have elections to the trust board and all the rest of it. But in the interim, under the interim trust board, it's just a question really how you're going to capitalise on the enthusiasm that we've obviously got from a pack day tonight. What plans do you have for a skills audit of the trust membership so that you find out if you've got professional fundraisers or people with a background in communications or volunteer management, all of which I guess would help you to get to that aspiration of the takeover?
Welcome any help whatsoever from any of the supporters. It's absolutely vital that that anybody please come forward and help with your skills, because it's quite right. There's a lot of people untapped out there, and you don't need too willing to actually meet with you and discuss it with you, and then look for an avenue to try and help this process along. Oh yes, good. Oh yes, sorry, I just reminded this form to the site. So we've already produced the form. If you can fill it, let us know all these skills.
So we've not done enough. On the current debt which the club has got now, which is not going to the trust, with the revenue which is coming in through the year, i.e. the Football League and everything like that, obviously, is that budgeted against what you've got to raise on the cost of, because we're in debt? You want to raise money, yes, but you've got thousands and thousands coming into the club at this present time. You've got the Football League money, you've got the transfer money and everything else. Is that ever accountable to what you're talking about now, raising the money to clear the debt, or is that already budgeted?
Yeah, I think you've got to understand that the budgets I've seen recognise all the Football League income, but they also anticipate spending all of that on player wages, staff wages, running costs, all the rest of it. So, broadly speaking, the club is going to operate in a sort of financially neutral way. It's not going to make big profits that would help it to discharge historical liabilities. So what's needed from this fundraising exercise is a capital sum that will pay off historical liabilities and allow the annual income that the club can generate to fund investment in the playing squad. The alternative scenario, which I think I touched on, of cutting your expenditure and paying off historical liabilities out of annual surpluses is going to make it harder for you to compete on the playing field. It's an option for the club, but I wouldn't think it's a sensible option.
I wanted to ask about the charitable status of the trust, if any, and whether or not the trust would be a legitimate beneficiary of a payroll giving scheme.
So it's not a charity that supports trust. Unfortunately, if we got into the position of owning the club, it wouldn't be able to claim a charitable status either. We are actually lobbying separately to recognise that community-owned clubs, the way they're set up and what they do, should receive the same benefits as charities, because there's a lot of goodwill and words from politicians that love this model. So we'd love to see that that's rewarded. So, funny enough, we've just launched a report this month to look at that. But as it stands, there's no kind of rights that you get as a charity. But what we have found is that clubs individually, with this model of ownership, can negotiate, lobby, speak to local authorities and others to get better rates. Based on, you know, the sort of activities they're involved with. You know, if they're doing a lot of good things and good work for the community, then there's a possibility of rate relief, which we've seen at other clubs, and changes to leases and various things. So I think there's there's no kind of legal right to it, but there's definitely some opportunities if the club is sold in the right way.
I think you just partly answered my question. The issue which I was going to raise was if the trust is set up and obviously in operation, if you were just to purchase equipment, etc., would you be VAT excluded? Which I think you seem to have answered partly. Is there any possibility you would avoid paying VAT by using just the trust fund to buy equipment? You said you're going to use it to pay off the debt. I would have thought it interesting, you might get debt paid back excluded. I'm not sure, but you might know the answer to that.
Yeah, it's probably simpler than that, really. The club will be VAT registered, it has to be, because of the size of operation. I think if you have over 70,000 of income, you have to be VAT registered. So it can already reclaim all of its VAT on expenditure. So there would be no real need to try and exploit any other benefits. It's already VAT registered.
Yeah, just looking at guidance for fans, a hypothetical question on picking any sun. Guidance for what you would want the fans to do with their money for the immediate plan and the future plan. If I had £100, would you want me to put the £100 into the shareholding? Would you want me to put £100 to join the trust? Or would you want me to do, say, £10 into the trust, £90 into the shareholding? What's the priority at the moment?
The priority would have to be as much as you can into the share ownership.
I mean, how would that get in the share ownership?
Yeah, I mean, £10 gives you access, one member, one vote, which we don't want to prevent people having a say. But in terms of finance, share ownership, because actually you'll get back if you don't get near our target.
The reason I ask you, Sean, is there's a lot of firms say stuff on the forum that join the trust, join the trust, join the trust. But isn't it at the moment is put money into the shares, into the shares, into the shares?
Yeah, I think that's where we moved to today. We had a quite detailed discussion on this, because when it obviously came out what was going on, we put a stop on trust membership, because we thought we didn't want people in a rush joining the trust, because we didn't know what financial situation we were dealing with. So we reopened trust membership earlier this week, knowing that this was coming about. So we'd be in a lot better position to actually give some idea on what sort of finances to deal with a major issue would be required. So we didn't want to stop people joining the trust and lose that goodwill for the last couple of days or so. So that's why we've taken that course.
Yeah, thanks, Sean. I just wanted clarity on that. Cheers, thanks.
Hi, Sean. It was mentioned as up to the 30th of June this year is reported loans of 500,000 to 600,000. That was mentioned on one of the slides. Yeah. 500,000 or 600,000. What is it, an exact figure? But also, would the banks now be happy to carry on with the repayment plans of what they are, or would they be putting pressure on you to, because of the situation with the club now? Would that change, or have you sort of come to an arrangement with the banks? Or are you talking this 500,000 or 600,000 to be, still paid off over a period of whatever it is? It was 500,000, it was the figure was 500,000 to 600,000.
Yeah.
Have you not got an exact figure of what the loans are?
We haven't. No, I
mean, or because of confidentiality, or because it's just 500,000 or 600,000. That's a lot of money between 500,000 and 600,000, isn't it?
No, I quite agree it is. There's a number of problems. One is that the people working at the club, I get the impression, are not quite up to date themselves. To a great extent, the information we've relied upon is just there. Verbal representation saying this is what it is. We've not been able to verify that by looking at the club's own records. So there's a lot of uncertainty there. But also it's changing week to week. The usual thing that companies in trouble do is they don't pay their POAE or their VAT. I'm not saying the club hasn't, but I don't know if they have or not. So, you know, there is uncertainty there. I guess the bank balance is going up and down all the time. I believe that the club has an overdraft facility, but if the sponsor pays money in advance, the overdraft goes down. If they pay the wages, the overdraft goes up. So at any week in the month, the net indebtedness of the club is going up and down. So I'm afraid we can't be more specific than that at the moment. We'll get there. You know, I explained that more work needed to be done, but we can't be more specific at the moment.
I've been following the Bud Company for 65 years. Next to my family, they're my life. I would like to say that you stated that the present company still run the club. Okay, fair enough. Until we take over, then we know what's what. And this isn't news today. It was intended that Albert Greenough would put his money, his shares, to the trust at tonight's meeting. Why hasn't it been mentioned, please?
I think, obviously, as Jamie mentioned earlier, that move towards 90% and triggering that EIS and tax relief would be very welcome. So, obviously, Howard's contribution and passing the shares over to the trust is fantastic news to us because it gets us pretty close to that 90% mark. So, the only thing we can say here is that it's total welcome gesture from Howard and very much appreciated. Yeah, there's no other side to it than that, I don't think.
We've had
had support from Kevin Moore. You probably saw more of him on the floor than he sent his support. So, I know we could go on all night, but they told us what's necessary. It's up to us. We formed the club originally. We succeeded in getting league football back to Newport. We don't want to lose it now, do we?
No,
it's up to us to make sure that we keep it going. So anyone here who's not a member of the trust, well, you can find £10 to be a member. And then please just pledge as much as you possibly can for what I call a fighting club. Thank you very much.
Pitch for the target and the share offer doesn't get enough interest, then the supporters' bid in that form won't go ahead. You know, everyone needs to be confident it's going to be viable and that money's not just going to disappear. So in that sense, it won't go ahead. I guess the big question is, well, what would happen with the football club? I'm tempted to pass the microphone at this stage, but you know, that is an unknown. You know, it's Les is the majority of the shares. Other people have got debts in the club. There may be other buyers that come forward. There may not be. You know, I think what we're trying to do tonight is at least say, okay, well, we'll give it our best shot. We'll do it in a way that is going to be fair, open, transparent. But we aren't just going to step into something that we can't afford, and that it's going to mean that lots of people lose a lot of money. So I think I'm tempted to say all we can do is control a bit that we can control, do that as quickly and professionally as possible, and see what the interest is. I don't know if anyone wants to add and sort of speculate as to the rest.
I'll just add to that that it's the current government's wish that the fans of this club take control. He's been very clear on that, and I think there was a statement outside, or there's a statement available. Am I right to say that? Which he makes it quite clear what he wants. Obviously, Howard is behind that. At least today or yesterday, publicly announced that he's donating his shares if this offer is successful, if it's really successful. So, you know, we've got other shareholders that are willing to donate their shares. So it looks like the trust could end up with the 90% shareholding, which obviously would be a great help for us to actually raise even further funds. So everybody's behind this offer that we're trying to do, and this bid to take control of the club.
Just following on that, we'd potentially could get to that 90%. Matt Stubbles indicated he'd be willing to donate his shares to the trust as well, so as you can imagine, we're not that far off the 90% target we're looking for at the moment to trigger that extra 30% on return on investment for individuals for the EIS scheme.
When will we find out the actual figure? You said we need a figure. When will we actually find out?
Well, I think as sort of Nick alluded to, the information that the report Nick produced contained a few assumptions because the information it didn't have was complete. So as quickly as we can, we need to follow up and be comfortable with the current financial position of the club, but there will also be some more follow-up with the various creditors and people that are owed the money. You know, I think there's been a fair amount of work that's happened. So as soon as, I mean, that's basically top of the inbox tray, as it were, to get around those issues, because as we said, we want to go out as quickly as possible, but we need to find the answers to those questions so that we can set a target figure. So, I mean, I'd hope we can get something out, I don't know, by the end of next week, but it might be the week after, depends on getting the answers. But I think, as I said, it's in everyone's interest to get it as quickly as possible, and I don't just mean us here, you know, it's the people that are owed the money as well.
Why don't we know what sort of money we're looking at? You're asking us for money, this is not a problem. We need to know what it is so we can build towards that. But if you don't know, how is the present circumstance board not letting you know so we can do something about that?
Yeah, it's not that anyone's been obstructed, it just takes time to go and fulfill a full due diligence on it, as well as to support the initial work that Nick has done. We've also considered the level of honesty and transparency, and we're conscious the last thing we want to do here tonight is come and give you a figure that is inaccurate, and then I'll go back to you in about a week's time and say, actually, we were wrong. We actually need this much in sales.
What's been going on over the years?
Yeah, well, we're going to aim to end that and be honest, open and transparent and let you know just exactly what figure we're looking for. So we've given you that range, but obviously in the next week we'll look to firm that completely so we can be totally honest, upfront, and know what we're dealing with.
As we said, the peak of 500, so we'll nail that down in the next week or so, once we get the information you require.
Just touch quickly on that as well. Obviously, there'll be another piece of work that will go on then, to actually looking at restructuring that, and potentially seeing what we can do to make it as palatable as possible, and achievable as possible. So there's obviously work emanating from that that we'd be following on and doing as well, just to make sure it's as affordable and as possible and totally ring-fenced and controlled.
What I want to know is what's the in the past, or what is the record of possible failure that clubs have become trust members in the past? Has most clubs continued as a successful trust membership?
Sorry, so you're saying how does the trust membership potentially grow and the support ownership looking at other clubs? It's a good question actually, because we're in absolutely any way disrespecting the work that's gone on with the trust so far. You know, clearly, suddenly owning and controlling a football club is a different matter. We've heard about getting more skills on, but it creates a lot more interest. So I was lucky to work closely with Wrexham when they took control there, and at the point of them having a meeting like this and raising the money, their membership was not much more than 500, and now their membership is just over 4,000. Similar tales at places like Exeter City. So I think there's a real potential to, you know, look at getting 10 times the number. As I say, it's a different sound. Owning your football club, you know, lots of people perhaps have always bought into what the trust stands for, but, you know, without some of the influence that you guys would now have through the trust, it's not obviously as attractive as a proposition. So, you know, everyone would want to see as many people joining, as many people volunteering, voting, investing, doing whatever they can, finding a way. And then I said, it doesn't have to be at board level. It's really finding a structure where if anyone wants to contribute anything, there's a place for them to do it. So.
Oh, any failures, sorry.
Yes, there has. I'm just giving you the sunny side up approach. No, unfortunately, I mean, it's always an interesting one, because it's, in our mind, some of the clubs, particularly 5-6 years ago, you had clubs like Stockport County, Notts County, and then before that, other clubs like Chesterfield in York City, who have been in supporter ownership and then gone back out into private ownership. Now, each has got a story and reason behind it, and I certainly wouldn't call any of them failure, but they aren't now in supporter ownership, so there's different circumstances to each. For example, most people know about Notts County. That was, a bit of a sad tale in the end. The supporters trust came in and did a fantastic job to safeguard the club, but then their members decided that they didn't want to continue owning it and ended up saying we're happy to transfer the ownership to the private investor, and unfortunately they didn't do their due diligence in that example. Stockport County were in trust ownership and took on the club, as I sort of alluded to earlier, often, particularly in the past, supporters came together to take over the club when it was in the worst financial position. So people might remember Stockport's story. They went from owning their grounds to suddenly going into administration, losing their ground, and suddenly paying a very high rent to play at their ground. So the supporters came in and did a good job initially, but again, it didn't work out there. So it doesn't always work out. I would caveat it in saying it still compares, the records still compare very favourably to private ownership, if you look at the number of private owning clubs that have got into trouble. And I would say that, you know, the powerful thing is
as transparent as possible from here on in. Bearing in mind we're under a confidentiality agreement, but we'll inform on progress.
You've given us a lot of information tonight, so I see nothing about your time to tell you progress.
I think it's all fine. We'll carry on what we've tried to do over the last 2-3 weeks, our regular statements, working closely with the IRS, making sure that we're safe there to everybody as well. So as soon as we start making some progress, we're looking at a date where we're going to get information. We'll update you on that as well. So we'll continue to communicate effectively on this through the IRS and through the web page and probably through Twitter.
Specifically, who is it that's holding you to the confidentiality clause? Who's insisted on you being confidential? Well, I mean, it's signed by the club, it's signed by Les, it's signed by the trust. I think one thing to say, just on the, going back to the other point as well, was, I mean, I don't know what you're doing next Friday, but yeah, I'd love it. Next Friday, or maybe the Friday after, perhaps give us at least a week off, to have a meeting like this and say, this is the share offer, and you thought you had enough information tonight. No, this is literally everything, you know. This is the club, this is what it would, you know, and I think we're all champing at the bit to get to that point. So, in terms of transparency and communicate, you're going to probably be bored, I would hope, of us in the next 2 or 3 weeks, because, you know, to be honest, we want to offload it to everyone, because it's a support our own bid. So we want everyone to know everything, because that's the way we're going to raise the most amount of money, or that's the way we're going to realise that it's not going to move ahead. So I think we sort of talked about it. It's just getting the information now. I don't think anyone's being particularly obstructive. It's just getting that information, getting the target figure, and having another Friday down here, and you know, really just going through everything again, and seeing whether there's, you know, there is the interest. I mean, there's interest in numbers. I think there's interest in lots of support for people giving shares and things. So, you know, in the end, sadly, it's going to be how much we can get in that account to show that we've got the confidence to take on the club.
So are you saying that it's Les who's offered us his shares, but is the person that's insisting on you being confidential with the information?
Well, I think it's
insisted on the confidentiality clause.
No. It's more that we just want to get accurate information, and you know, which we don't fully have for different reasons. But no one's obstructing it. There isn't a story there. It's just, you know, it'd be wrong really to come out with information that is based on assumption. So we want to get to the bottom of these points. You know, as I said, it's the number one priority for everyone here.
Can I just add, though, it is quite customary when you're at this sort of exploratory stage for a company that might be for sale to want to retain confidentiality until it's confident that the person who wants to buy the company has got the means to do it and is absolutely serious. Because otherwise, you know, there's a risk that all sorts of information about the club, its player wages, its manager's wage, all that sort of thing, would be out of public domain. And if, I'm not saying it is for a minute, but if the trust had been frivolous about this and there hadn't been restrictions on what they could divulge, it could just be leaked in a very disorganised way, which would be unhelpful to the club if the trust didn't then proceed with the bid. So that's the reason why it's commonplace to have this sort of agreement. What we hope we'll now move to is an agreement from the club and Les to actually divulge more to you once we've demonstrated to them that we're actually going to be serious about this bid.
Yeah, currently it's 455 members, that was as of this evening. I've just given another 8 from Lisa, so hopefully people will fill in the forms on the way out and we can increase that to well over 500.
Just as a closing reminders, if you've got any other questions, and obviously you don't want to speak up in the audience, I'll be outside, so the other trust members, so if you want to talk to us, no problem at all, we'll answer what we can. It looks like there's 500 people here tonight, so it's been a fantastic turnout. Obviously there's forms outside to join the trust, volunteers to register a trade or professional skill. These sheets which answer a lot of questions on the topics outside. Just to remind you that the ticket office is open 10 to 3 on Saturday, to purchase any tickets for the QPR game. Don't forget about meet the manager, and obviously please increase the season ticket sales if you're thinking about why we're buying them and the price to buy them, so to help the club to yeah. Sorry?
I think it's 15, and I don't want to say yes or no.
Yes, that's my fault.
I thought it was 15 pounds, is that right or not?
15,
yeah, okay. is there a difference for OIPs? Is OIPs concession 10 pounds? Mike's going on the website, so it's £10 concessions. Thanks.
Okay, we'd just like to thank everybody for coming, and we really do urge you to support this bid, and please get behind it, because this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Take my word for it. No one ever.